Hi everyone. So in this video, I wanted to discuss Web3 AI full stack development with so many buzzwords around. Which one should you probably choose today? And more specifically, a very nice learning path in all three. To set some context for the video, the reason I wanted to make the video was I feel, and I could totally be wrong here, that 3 to 4 months of consistent studying is enough to learn any one of these three technologies. Why do I feel this? Because full stack is considered hard conventionally, but in my course that I'm teaching, it's only been 2 months and I see people are at a very nice level where I'll sort of share when I share the Web3, the full stack roadmap. The point is I've sort of understood at this point that if you're consistent, that's the only prerequisite, then it's easy for you to learn a new technology. In this video, I wanted to talk about what are those sort of humps that come in the journey of learning full stack, AI or Web3, which if you go over, if someone is there to pull you during those humps, because those are the humps where people are just like, this is probably not for me, and they move on to whatever they were doing before learning full stack, Web3, AI. So what are those humps? And what can you do during those paths when you get stuck somewhere, and how you can continue the journey, because consistency is key when it comes to learning any technology. Cool. Let's get right into the video. So let's discuss firstly, what's the difference between Web3, AI and full stack, why you should choose one over the other. And frankly, I have no answer for this. It really depends on personal choice. Of course, if you look at the market right now, AI is the most hot thing. After that, I would say there is full stack, because full stack can be used in all sort of companies, be it a Web3 company, be it an AI company. And of course, normal standard companies do require full stack. And then I'd keep Web3 at the very bottom. If I had to like not give you advice as a big brother, but like as a friend, I would say probably stick with Web3. And the reason is when the bull comes, you're very well positioned. But we're talking like mentors here. And then the obvious advice here is AI is on a boom. So that's probably the right thing for you to learn. Before you learn Web3 and AI though, I feel full stack is a good base for you to have. The reason is, if you start down that path, right, of Web3 and AI, it's very hard for you to go down to this thing called full stack. So it's always good to have a very nice foundation of basic full stack. I say the same for DSA as well. Do DSA, understand it a little bit. At least you should know what's happening. In the future, if you have a DSA interview, you know what to do. Cool. So I would start with full stack either way. And then finally, if I had to choose today and I was starting from a clean slate, I would go with AI. Personally, I am learning AI as well. I hired a friend of mine, not really hired, but like someone who teaches me 30 minutes in a week. Very nice sort of guided path in a one-on-one session where he's been teaching me how to learn AI. And I feel 4 months are actually enough for me to gain enough context, because the person who's teaching me is sort of a PhD and has worked in Facebook, yada yada. So he's pretty good at what he does and he knows what's being used in the industry. If you have a mentor like this, then it's sort of easier to go through that path versus if you're, you know, scrambling through resources. So what is the actionable advice before we start the video? Actionable advice is either find friends or a personalized mentor, a brother, sister, someone who, when you get stuck during these humps, helps you out with some personalized doubts. And secondly, gives you some accountability through this journey, because if you can stick through it for 3 to 4 months, trust me, that's sort of where the inflection point comes. Cool. Let's get right into the video. So the first thing I want to discuss was full stack. What are the learning paths and where do the humps come? I know this very well now because I'm teaching a course. So there I've seen this practically with a bunch of students where people got stuck. And personally for me, I've seen 3 months, 4 months are good enough to learn it. The first thing you need to learn is learning JavaScript. So this is for people who have not programmed at all. You will have to learn a language first, and this will be your first biggest hump. Learning JS, just the syntax and understanding its single threaded nature, how it's different from a language like Rust or Golang or Java, but why it's necessary, because the browser sort of only understands JavaScript. Once you go over that hump, once you've understood JavaScript, your journey will be very smooth, writing very basic backend applications, because Node.js, JavaScript, very similar. You just need to understand something called HTTP servers. Once you do, you're good to go. There's like no real hump in writing backend applications until you go to frontend. Frontend also, if you write basic frontend in HTML, CSS, JavaScript, you're mostly fine. When React comes into the picture, that's the second biggest hump for most people. This is where I saw a lot of people filtering out, a lot of people asking for extra questions, extra doubts, extra classes during the course. And I saw this personally myself as well when I was learning. So the second biggest hump in the full stack journey is going to be React. If you can pull through this, then you're pretty much sorted in a very decent situation. This is the biggest hump in the full stack journey, which is learning React. Once you know how to write backends and frontends in React and a standard Node.js application, a very basic MernStack app, The next hump comes when you start moving from JavaScript to TypeScript. That's also not a very big hump, but feels a little jarring. Why are we making our lives as developers much harder writing highly verbose code when we were like very simply going through basic with non-typed JavaScript? But the answer here is, in a very big code base, most open source projects, most good projects, the code will not be in JavaScript. It will be in TypeScript. There are benefits to it. What are benefits? You can read through a bunch of videos, but you'll have to eventually learn TypeScript. And this is the third hump. Once you go through this third hump, the last thing is not really needed, but what differentiates you is some high level frameworks, things more than HTTP, things like TRPC, things like GraphQL. These are not specific to the MERN stack, happen in most languages, and this is where the world is moving slowly. So you will have to at some point understand these, but the first three are actually good enough. If you can write type safe applications in the MERN stack, you're pretty well sorted. You can call yourself a full stack engineer at that point. If you want to learn more, there's actually no end to how much you can learn, because there's like a bunch of communication protocols, there is backend communication, there are like tons of things that come in. More complex full stack applications, but a basic website, a good basic website, front end, back end. If you can write in a type safe manner, you're sorted. Cool. This is the journey for full stack. I don't think you need more than 4 months to understand all of this. Again, everyone's speed is different, but if you're consistent, by which I mean you're putting in 20 hours a week and you're not really taking breaks in the middle, because once you take a break, you're pretty much at square one. That's something I've seen in tech as well. So if you stick through it, then I think 4 months is good enough to learn all of this. If you want to go beyond this, there are a few paths I've written down. One is learning React Native, so mobile development. If you know React, fairly easy to move to React Native. Although, as you sort of start developing applications, you will start to or need to understand Android development, iOS development. So if you want to go down that niche, feel free to. But it's an easy starting point if you've learned React already. And there's CI/CD, general DevOps, and figuring out how you can deploy your app in a dumb manner, but hopefully through better tools like Kubernetes, containerization, infrastructure as code. So that way you become a very nice one person, army one person team. Whoever hires you doesn't need to hire a DevOps person, a front-end engineer, a back-end engineer. You can do everything. And if you want to start your own startup, you pretty much have all the context to build a website end-to-end, deploy it in a very scalable fashion. I think all of this 4 months is decent. And I think the same applies to at least Web3 AI. I'm not sure, I'm myself learning, but let's try to now understand the roadmap to Web3. Small plug here, my Web3 roadmap video is coming, not a roadmap this time, it's like a Web3 bootcamp, which will be 4 to 5 very long videos. By very long, I mean 4 or 5 hours, where I will be basically teaching all the things that I'm going to share now, and what are all these humps that come, how you can go through them hopefully with me on this YouTube channel. Cool. Starting out, so the first hump that comes is not a lot of people use Web3. So people don't understand very basic terms like private keys, what are public keys, what is the sex, what is a decentralized exchange, and why even use Web3 in a bunch of use cases. So you have to sort of twist your mind a little, this is how things are done, and these are the use cases of the future that may or may not become popular at some point. But at some points, you'll see yourself questioning as to why we are doing this in a Web3 way, and you should probably just build a website for it, and you just have to sort of stick through it during those times. And I have a very long video with Harnoor where I was telling him like 10 such jargons, what are private keys, what's an NFT, how's an NFT different from a token. I'm happy to release it. It's a very sort of all over the place video, which is why I haven't released it, but if you guys feel like it, I'm happy to release it on another channel, on the main channel. We just discuss a bunch of Web3 jargon and try to explain Harnoor very standard terms that sort of perplex you when you start. Once you've gone through this is when you start coding. So the next big hump is EVM development. So in Solidity, in Web3 generally, you don't necessarily have to write this thing called smart contracts, but it's good if you're a smart contract engineer versus a person who's just, you know, writing client-side code or centralized backends for a company. You could totally be a full-stack engineer for a Web3 company, but the whole idea here is to, and for that, you just need to understand the basic jargon and a little bit of, you know, this library called web3.js that lets you interact with the blockchain. But it's good for you to at least understand how to write smart contracts or actually be a smart contract engineer. That's where the solid moat is. That's the thing that you need to learn here. To learn that, there are a bunch of blockchains, and every blockchain sort of has their own way of writing smart contracts. The first one that you should start with is EVM development. So this is Ethereum, Polygon, a bunch of chains that let you deploy smart contracts in Solidity. So what is Solidity? Solidity is a language of its own. So the next hump comes when you have to learn this new language. This is going to be my first video in the bootcamp where we're going to learn Solidity end to end, write a contract and even write a website for it. Cool. So what's the biggest hump here? After you've learned jargon, it is learning Solidity and writing smart contracts, understanding how now functions can also, when someone is calling a function in a backend full stack application, a web 2 world, you don't really send money. I mean, you do in like Flipkart or whatever, a course selling website. But when it comes to calling a function, it's just like really hard for you to send the money unless you have like Razorpay integrations and all that. Just, I'm deviating, I feel, so let me come back. There are a few extra things that you can write in a smart contract that are slightly different from a web 2 backend. And secondly, your web 2 backends, you deploy on AWS yourself. Your web 3 Solidity programs, smart contracts, whatever you want to call it, are deployed on the blockchain. So there's no real CI/CD here, or more specifically, there's no DevOps here. You don't deploy anything to AWS. Everything gets deployed to a network of computers. And that's another mind shift of, oh, where is my backend code going? Going on the blockchain. So what is the next hump? After you've done basic jargon, after you've done Solidity, you're able to write smart contracts on your own. The third hump is moving beyond EVM, which is you can now write smart contracts. You can also maybe create a website for your smart contract, which is called like a DApp, a decentralized app. Once you've done that, you need to now move across chains. So you can basically write smart contracts in Solidity for Ethereum and a bunch of other blockchains. But if you want to either create a blockchain of your own, so you have to understand this blockchain called Cosmos or Polkadot, or if you want to move to other blockchains like Solana, you need to understand how smart contracts are written there. And they're very different from how smart contracts are written on Solidity or Ethereum. The data model is different. How the data is stored is different. How you send money / gas for every interaction is very different between these chains. So when you move from, let's say, Solidity to Solana development, you need to understand the language to write code in Solana, which is Rust or C. So the next hump is understanding Rust or C, then writing smart contracts in Solana, which are very different from writing smart contracts in Ethereum. Cool. Once you've done this, and you can write smart contracts across chains, which includes Cosmos, Solana, or Ethereum. The next step, which I find very fascinating and I'm personally excited about, and we'll have a video of that very soon, is when you move assets across blockchains. What does that mean? Just think of it like, I have Ethereum on the Ethereum blockchain, how can I move it to Solana? I have Solana on the Solana blockchain, how can I move it to Ethereum? Might feel a little weird. It is weird when we get into the intricacies of how it's actually done. It'll feel actually fairly dumb, but there are projects out there that let you do this, and it's actually a pretty ingenious thing to do. If you understand this, you understand pretty much all that's not all, but like most of things that are required for Ethereum development or for Solana development, because you can now move assets from one chain to another. If you understand how that's done under the hood, if you can write something like this yourself, it's pretty solid. You're a pretty solid engineer by then. Cool. That's the steps that I know. And these are the steps that we are going to follow in the videos to come. Very high level. First video is going to be Solidity development, understanding Solidity, the language, and writing our own contract and deploying it. Second video is probably going to be some advanced contracts. Third video is going to be Solana development. Fourth video, or the fifth video, is going to be moving across blockchains. We might do Cosmos as well. That's the general flow of the Web3 bootcamp that's coming for free on my YouTube channel. Cool. Moving on. AI. So a bunch of disclaimers here. One, I have not done AI development at all, other than when I was applying for my master's, I was trying to impress professors in the US. And so I sort of did the Andrew Ng course. I did it a few years ago, so I have zero context on AI now. I understand things from the very high level, but I need a very focused path to learn this. I do want to learn this as a hobby, not as like a business or anything. And for that, I sort of called a few friends. A lot of my friends sort of went for masters and PhDs and work at pretty nice places. So I asked one to just take out 30 minutes in a week, or more specifically an hour every 15 days. So we meet every 15 days and he just gives me a very high level path of, one, what is happening in the industry, and two, how I should learn it. It's not a good idea to, for example, learn TypeScript directly. You should start with building JavaScript code or like JavaScript websites. Similarly, he's sort of guiding me week on week as to what I should learn. If I reach the goals for that week is when we sort of move to the next thing. We've met two times now, and the only thing we've done until now, the first session was just learn Python, and not just like basic Python of writing HTTP servers. You should also understand these libraries called TensorFlow, NumPy, Pandas, and how you can write very basic code in them, functions and manipulation of arrays. That's what he asked me to do. That was fairly simple, frankly. That's what I learned for the first 15 days. Now he has asked me to go through a few lectures for supervised learning, unsupervised learning and deep learning. I have no idea what this is. This I know. I did this back in the day, so I have a little bit of idea what these are. And neural networks we did back in college. So I have a decent idea of what these, not a decent idea. I have like a very high level idea from memory. Now I have to learn these three things. He has asked me to go through the Andrew NG course again, which is what I'm going to do next. And then he's told me we'll move beyond this because apparently these things are not used today. And then something else is used, which he's going to teach me next. But this is what will create my foundation. This is where I'm at. I'm happy to share my journey. As time comes by, if you want to join the session, he charges like $200 an hour, something like that. If you want to join, I can ask him and more people can join. I don't mind if someone else is there with me as long as the group is small. But that's how I'm learning AI. I think this is a pretty decent way to learn any technology. If you find someone who's good at it, pay them some whatever their hourly rate is and then try to learn as much as you can from them, because they're in the industry, they know what's being used, and hopefully if they're a decent teacher, they can guide you through small incremental steps to learning the final thing. If you dive directly into the final thing, one, your foundation isn't really good, and secondly, you might just be like, I don't want to do this, I'll go back to my web2 job or whatever. Cool. So these are the humps. If you're a complete beginner, have never coded, first thing you should probably do is full stack. There will be humps in the journey, but hopefully if you get through all of them, 4 months are good enough to learn everything. If you already know full stack, work in some company, Bangalore, on site, remote, whatever, and you want to learn one of these two technologies, Web3, you can learn with me on the channel. It will be probably 4 or 5 videos in the next 2 months. Or you can go to other resources as well. I've listed down the things that I feel is the right path to learn Web3. And then finally, AI. I am learning. I'm happy to share the journey here either through community posts or if you really want to join my friend in a small group, feel free to join Discord and ping me or just comment down and I can just ask him if he's open to this. Cool. Thank you, everyone. That was a hopefully helps you understand how to learn these things. What you should learn really depends on you. If I was a clean slate guy today, like I don't know coding at all, I'd go with full stack. If I was a full stack guy, I'd probably go with AI. But a personal plug here, okay, Web3 is, if you want to learn, it's coming on my channel. And why should you learn Web3 when AI is at its peak right now? Because you start here. And then when the bull comes, you sort of reap the rewards. That will be my 2 cents. But again, feel free to make an informed decision. With that, let's end the video. I'll see you in the next one. Bye.